running a little bit late, and I'm sure folks have other things to do today, especially after that pep talk. And this panel seems a little out of place, but there's one thing we do know about what's coming, and that is that whatever it is, we'll lose revenue. And at some point, we're going to need to replace that revenue. We have a great panel here to help us with that and enlighten us about some new types of taxes that haven't been enacted before here in the U.S., but that we might want to think about long-term. New taxes take a while for people to accept and to work out the kinks, so it's good to go ahead and keep talking about them. We're going to talk about a carbon tax, a VAT tax, a financial transactions tax, and increased taxes to fund Social Security. Our impressive panel of wise experts here, I'll start from down the farthest to my right here, is Frank Ackerman. He's principal economist at Synapse Energy Economics, a public interest-oriented consulting firm in Cambridge, Massachusetts. Frank is an environmental economist, and he's got a long list of publications to his credit and has testified, invited to testify at the federal and state level many times. He's also currently a lecturer at MIT in his field, and he's going to talk with us about a carbon tax, which he studied extensively. The next is Tom Hungerford. He's an associate commissioner for retirement policy at the Social Security Administration currently, but many of us know him from his previous position as senior economist and director of the Economic Policy Institute. He's also worked at GAO, OMB, and the Congressional Research Service, so he has a very rich perspective to bring to tax issues. And he can speak knowledgeably on a lot of tax issues, but he's going to focus his remarks today on value-added taxes, which it turns out may actually be really a little bit relevant. And the next is Dean Baker, co-director of Center for Economic and Policy Research. Dean is an economist who has kind of a knack for clarifying what economic policy means for the average person. So we'll be looking for him to help us with that. He's the author of several books, and his most recent is entitled Rigged: How Globalization and the Rules of the Modern Economy Were Structured to Make the Rich Richer. He provides analysis and commentary in his blog, Beat the Press, which he spoke of earlier, and in numerous published articles, and he's going to talk today about financial transaction taxes. And finally, we have Kathleen Romig to my right, senior policy analyst at the Center on Budget and Policy Priorities. She works on Social Security, supplemental security income, and other budget issues. She previously worked at the Social Security Administration as well, the Social Security Advisory Board, and Congressional Research Service. And we're pleased to have her here to enlighten us about reforming payroll taxes to fund Social Security. So with that, each of our panelists is going to take about 7 minutes or so to talk about their assigned tax. And we'll start with Frank.
This was not the context I thought I was going to be speaking in. I had no idea that nobody else was using PowerPoint. Bear with me, we'll see how it works. The recent election made carbon taxes much more likely if you happen to live in Canada, where they seem to be taking this seriously. But do the next slide. As Canadians all know, can we advance the slide? Yes, there we go. As Canadians all know, the argument for a carbon tax is not primarily a fiscal or budgetary one. Rather, as most of you probably also know, carbon emissions are moving the world above the temperature range in which both human beings and all of our favorite foods evolved. And ponder the implications of that. The pace of change is known to be uncertain. There are deep reasons why we cannot nail down exactly how fast it's going, including the fact that we cannot rule out dangerously more rapid change than the mainstream forecasts expect. In this context, a price on carbon is a necessary but not sufficient part of the response to this. There are other things that have to be done, but basically no economists think that we can do it without putting a price on carbon. It matters much more what the price is and much less whether it's a tax or a cap and trade system. Either one with a low price does very little, either one with a high price does a lot more. Go to the next slide. There's a well-known economic theory that says the optimal tax, the ideal tax level, would be to figure out what's the damage done by a ton of carbon dioxide emissions and set it exactly to that level. So the social cost of carbon, the phrase that's been used for this estimate of damages, the Obama administration had a task force which ran a series of standard models and has come up with an estimate that is in round numbers $40 per ton of CO2 today. This number is based on models that minimize some of the serious risks that other analyses have looked at. Other economists, myself included, have produced equally plausible arguments why it could be 3 to 10 times higher. So if the cost of the damages that are done by climate change are uncertain over an order of magnitude, there's no hope of getting the prices right, as economists like to say in the classroom. The pragmatic alternative, I think, is to say what price helps the most at reducing carbon emissions, which is really the only goal here. Too high a price is politically infeasible, too low a price isn't worth bothering with, doesn't accomplish anything. It seems at least possible that the federal analysis that suggested $40 a ton might give that a certain kind of legitimacy if one lived in a country where such things were legitimate. Next slide. We'll look at what are the likely effects of a $40 carbon tax on the two principal areas of emissions. In electricity, where there are a lot of choices of how to generate electricity, a lot of rival technologies, you would have huge effects. $40 a ton of carbon is essentially a 4 cents per kilowatt hour penalty on coal, 2.5 cents a kilowatt hour on natural gas. This is a huge change in their market position relative to renewables, relative to energy efficiency efforts. You would at the same time have windfall gains for existing nuclear and hydropower facilities, which have no current carbon emissions. But $40 a ton would transform the electrical system. It would do less to transform transportation because, unlike electricity, in most of the country there's only one way to produce transportation with private gasoline fuel vehicles. $40 a ton is in round numbers 40 cents a gallon of gas. That's a large enough tax to notice, although there are actually are four states that have gas taxes higher than that at present. But it is not enough to transform transportation. It will create a nudge towards slightly more fuel-efficient cars. If you really want to reduce emissions in transportation, you need other measures, mass transit, electric vehicle infrastructure, policies that move us much faster toward low-emission transportation. So next slide. I tried estimating what if a cold wind of common sense blew in from Canada and we were to adopt a $40 carbon tax. We might end up with $190 to $250 billion of revenue, depending on how you count our emissions, which would be 6 to 8% of current federal revenues. It's not a small number. There's already a well-established debate among carbon tax advocates about what should be done with the money. One approach says you need to give it back to people on a per capita basis in order to ease the pain of a regressive tax in order to make it popular. This did, in fact, make British Columbia's carbon tax quite popular. They do give it back that way. Opinions differ wildly amongst advocates about is this essential or is this not crucial to it. A second alternative says, should some or all of this revenue fund other climate initiatives, all the other things that need to be done to reduce emissions? California has done this with its cap and trade revenues to a considerable extent. The regional greenhouse gas initiative states in the Northeast with the smaller carbon revenues have also, most of them have used it to fund energy efficiency initiatives. Or finally, should this revenue allow reduction of other taxes or reduction of the deficit? Should it in some sense go into the general fund? This was proposed in the recent initiative, the 2016 initiative in Washington State, which failed at a time when other progressive initiatives were adopted, referendum ballots there. the risk of linkage, the risk of saying, oh, we can have the carbon tax replace, for instance, the payroll tax, is that you would thereby make, say, Social Security dependent on carbon revenues, so that either if we succeeded in reducing emissions or if we elected someone who cut the carbon tax in the future, you would thereby destabilize Social Security as well. So I think the idea of explicit linkage of, for instance, Social Security finances or any other big program we care about finances to a carbon tax is a danger to avoid. Better would be much better to apply the revenues to the general fund without linkage. My guess is that some combination of these different approaches is likely. I mean, I think there are arguments for all three. I doubt that it's an either or choice. But above all, I want to leave you with a thought on the last slide, that the success of a carbon tax is not primarily measured by its revenues.
I need to start out and just say that any views I express here are my views and not those of the Social Security Administration or the Obama Administration. I'm tasked with talking about a value-added tax, so maybe the first thing I need to do is just kind of define what a value-added tax is for some of the people who may be unfamiliar with that. And it's basically a tax collected at various stages of the production and distribution chain on firms' value added. That's just essentially the difference between sales and purchases of taxed inputs from other firms. The sum of value added at each stage is just the retail price. And so a value added tax is a consumption tax. It's a tax on aggregate consumption. Now, I'm not going to get into details on the design of a value added tax, but what I want to do is just focus more on some of the common arguments I've heard for a value-added tax and against a value-added tax. And if I can get my first slide, please. I've listed them here. And you know, for those of you who are familiar with value-added tax and have studied it, you probably figure out I was probably thinking of Larry Summers's quip from about 30 years ago on the value-added tax. And he ended up saying that liberals think it's regressive. Conservatives think it's a money machine. If they reverse their positions, that may happen. And so let me just kind of quickly go through these three arguments, and I'll actually just focus more on the first and the last argument. So I'll start off with the money machine argument. And this essentially starts from the premise that a VAT is too efficient. Okay, that a broad-based VAT doesn't distort prices and doesn't distort savings and investment decisions. Okay, and then conservatives arguing against a VAT also combine this with the feed the beast argument, that they say collecting more revenue will increase spending, thus increasing the size of government. And therefore, what we really need are inefficient and painful taxes to keep public support on the side of tax cuts so as to starve the beast and thus lead to a smaller government. And what I would argue is that a VAT is no more of a money machine than other taxes. And let me just give an example by comparing a VAT tax base with other tax bases. So if I can get the next slide, please. Okay, what I've done here is I'm just comparing the VAT tax base with payroll tax base and the individual income tax base. And the top line is just the theoretical tax base for each of these. One is just personal consumption expenditures in the case of the VAT, total compensation in the case of the payroll tax, and then just personal income in the case of individual income taxes. The next line down is what I would call a broad base tax base. That's a tax base with minimal tax expenditures or subtractions. And as you can see, we do lose a bit of the tax base because of a variety of tax expenditures. And then the last row ends up just showing what the likely tax base would be in the case of a VAT, or the actual tax base in the case of the payroll tax and the individual income tax. And There's two points I'm trying to get across here is that, well, one is tax expenditures quickly erode the tax base and reduce the tax take, and this is going to be true on all of these various kinds of taxes. Now, undoubtedly, a VAT will raise needed revenue, and one of the nice things about the VAT that Reuven had mentioned earlier is that at least it's, the tax base does not vary all that much. As we go through the business cycle and so on. So the revenues are a little bit more predictable. But, so as I said, it does raise needed revenue, but I just don't see any evidence that it is this efficient money machine that does feed the beast of government. And it's also been argued that once adopted, it's much easier to increase a VAT than it is other income taxes or other taxes such as income taxes, but there's really no evidence to support this argument also either. So if I could go back a slide, back to the pros and cons, I'll just quickly go over this, the second argument, and yeah, in and of itself, just saying that we should have a VAT because everybody else has one is rather silly, and of course it reminds me of what my mother said and everybody else's mother said when you tried that response as a kid, if everybody were jumping off a bridge, et cetera, et cetera. But the fact that everybody else does have one, it means that it's been well studied and well evaluated. And so if the United States were to adopt a VAT, we have a wealth of experience to draw on to come up with the best ways of designing and implementing a VAT, though that does get into sometimes American arrogance leads to American ignorance, just because we tend to ignore things. The last part, the last argument, and this is something that troubles me the most, is it's regressive, and of course a VAT is regressive. It's a consumption tax. Okay, but there are various ways to deal with the regressivity of the VAT. I'll just quickly go through these. First one is just through exclusions or multiple rates. Okay, but the unfortunate thing here is that it ends up narrowing the VAT tax base, reduces revenues, and actually would make the VAT less efficient by affecting relative prices. And all the evidence I've seen is it shows that it doesn't really have, going this route really doesn't have all that much effect on regressivity anyway. The next method is just having a VAT credit in the individual income tax, and other countries have gone this route. There is one problem with this is if you have a VAT, you need to keep the income tax, this just kind of goes out the door. And many people who have argued for a VAT or for an X tax are thinking about a replacement of the income tax, not as a supplement to the income tax. And then the last method would be just, let's deal with the regressivity through the spending side by making the social welfare system or the social insurance system a little bit stronger. And one of the things to keep in mind about going in this route is that some social insurance programs are indexed for price inflation. So if we adopted a VAT, prices go up. At least some people, such as Social Security recipients, would be held harmless, at least on their Social Security benefit. And then there are other social insurance programs, I'm thinking of public assistance, that are not indexed for inflation. Okay, so I'd say that a VAT, if it were adopted, is definitely it is definitely possible to overcome the regressive nature of the VAT. But if you go that route, one of the things you do have to keep in mind is that you do have to offset that regressivity through both the spending side and other tax programs. So you have to, with the VAT, you're going to have to combine it, or at least in my opinion, it should be combined with changes in the income tax, making the income tax more progressive, and I'm thinking both on the corporate side and the individual side, and also making the spending side more progressive. So I think a VAT should be considered. It's not going to be considered in the next few years. So Actually, I think all of our the new taxes we're talking about here are not going to be used in the next 4 years, but there's hope after that. So what we should do is combine a VAT with changing our tax and transfer system and making that more progressive.
Okay, I'll do a pitch for my financial transactions tax. And what I'll say a bit by way of background, I tend to focus more of my attention on before tax income inequality, because if we see what's been behind the big growth in income inequality over the last four decades, it's primarily been increasing before tax income inequality. And that was really the point of my book, was that this was by design. It wasn't just that, you know, rich people were very lucky and, you know, things broke in their favor. No, they cooked the books. And I don't mind plugging the book, it's available for free. Click on our website, but so I don't mind plugging it. But part of that story is in the financial sector, because that is where a lot of the highest incomes are. I think hedge fund people, think private equity people, Mitt Romney. So, you know, that's where a lot of the big fortunes have been made. And to my view, part of the story, people often talk about deregulation. I think that's kind of a misnomer, because basically what I see is we have a system of very partial regulation, and the issue is really whether the industry will pay for that regulation. What I mean by that is, well, first and foremost, we have the deposit insurance. I don't know many right-wingers want to get rid of that. You know, if they do, I think they're being dishonest. There are some countries that have private deposit insurance, and we found a big lie in that. That only holds up if you're not in a crisis. If you're in a crisis, the government bails it out. So it's kind of bogus that's private. It's not public. You can't afford to have your financial system collapse. And going back to 2008, there are very few Wall Street types who are saying, let it all crash. So basically, it's not a question of them wanting deregulation. They want insurance without paying for it. And I see part of the story in the financial sector, what's going on here, is that we've had a huge decrease in the cost of transactions that has caused an explosion in financial transactions. We've had an explosion in derivative instruments. It wouldn't have been possible if you go back 4 or 5 decades ago, because without modern computers, you couldn't have a lot of these instruments. You really need modern computers just to have them and certainly to trade them. So we've had this huge decline in costs, explosion of transactions, and part of that is that as these costs have come down, we have no taxes in the sector, and that's kind of unique. I mean, if we buy food, if we buy clothes, we pay a sales tax. There's no tax on financial transactions, or I shouldn't say no tax, a very, very small tax. I'll come back to that in a second. And in that sense, it enjoys a special privilege. It's an under-taxed sector. The International Monetary Fund had a very nice piece on this about 5 or 6 years ago, suggesting that we do have some taxes. Their preferred tax is, in effect, that in the financial sector. I prefer this for reasons that I'll explain. But in any case, you know, I see this as an issue of basically storing equity both between sectors and also hitting a lot of the people who are the highest earners in the economy. And one more thing I'll say about this. I raised the issue of financial transactions tax. A lot of people look like, well, this must be something from Mars. Well, actually, it's not. I mean, we've had financial transactions taxes in just about every country that I know of that's had a financial market. And, you know, one famous communist example, the UK taxes taxes trades of stock at the rate of 0.5%, half of 1% in every trade of stock. And last I looked, it was a capitalist country with a very vibrant stock market. The United States actually had a stamp transfer tax until I think it was 64 of 0.04% for hundreds of 1%. We removed it then. Even to this day, we have a very, very small tax. I was just trying to look it up. Sorry, being rude, I was trying to remember what it was as you guys were talking. It's somewhere in the order of 0.001%. It raises about $800 million a year to pay for the Securities and Exchange Commission. So this is not an unknown story. So what I want to argue is, A, this is a tax that comes out of the waste in the industry. I know if we have anyone from the financial industry, they won't like me calling them waste, but I will argue it's waste, and B, can raise a lot of money. So if I could get my first slide up. Okay, this is taking you back to Econ 101, just, you know, very, very simple story. What happens when we impose a tax on the market? And, you know, this is not the actual car market, I very stylized, but I just said, let's say we have a tax of $5,000 on cars. And I just drew this as a very simple story. What we expect to happen is that it's more or less split in some fashion between the consumers and the suppliers. And, you know, I have it evenly split here. It never will actually be evenly split, but just make it simple. And what that means is that consumers pay $2,500 more for each car they buy, and suppliers receive $2,500 less. The other part of the story is we buy fewer cars. So I had us buying originally 22 million cars, we ended up only buying 20 million cars. Now, the cost, what the Economist refers to the cost of the taxes, the gain we would have gotten from those 2 million cars. So, you know, we would have bought 2 million more cars a year, the people would have bought those cars, would have valued them, now they're not getting that. So that's the loss. The rest of it is money that used to go to consumers. I'm paying more for my car when I buy it, instead goes to the government. Used to go to suppliers, they're gonna get less money, instead goes to the government. Whether it's good or bad depends what they use it for. Okay, so that's a story, what we would think of with cars or, you know, tables, whatever we might tax, normal goods. You know, we get the next slide. Okay, so I'm basically showing the exact same picture, but I'm just saying that this is quantity of trades. So quantity of trades falls back from 22 million to 20 million. Okay, now in this story, I have people spending just as much on trades as they did previously, but they're doing fewer trades. Okay, so the question is, do they feel bad about that? Okay, so I went from 22 million cars to 20 million cars. I'm supposed to be less happy. Now, maybe I should be more happy because it's better than walking or driving, but we'll leave that out. We'll say that, you know, I would have been happy having the cars. Okay, are people less happy because of the trades? Well, ordinarily, we wouldn't think so. I mean, there might be some people who are gambling on the stock market, but we'll ignore those. I mean, gambling like enjoying it, you know, like, wow, you know, I just bought 10,000 shares of General Electric and I hope it wins, but maybe I'll lose. You know, that's fun. I mean, there might be some people like that, but let's just say that they're few and far between. People trade in principle, you know, we have retirement accounts, 401k accounts. This is your retirement money. You care about trades, does it make you richer? Well, on average, I would say it doesn't. Okay, so I trade with someone else and, you know, I win or I lose, that person is the flip side. Okay, so I made a real good deal. I bought General Electric at a good time. Someone else had the bad luck to sell it at a, you know, real low point. Well, they were a loser, I'm a winner. Does that help the aggregate economy? I would argue it does not. You're very hard pressed to make a story that we've seen an increase in, the argument would be the efficiency of the market, and you should be careful I'm using that, the effectiveness of the market in allocating capital over the last four decades because of the decline in transactions costs, because of the increase in trading volume. Now that's an arguable point, but I'm going to say there's very little evidence that the increased trading has led to a better allocation of capital. If that sounds strange to you, did we allocate capital well during the housing bubble? Okay, I'm maybe taking a straw man here, but I think you'd be hard-pressed to make that argument. Okay, and I would just say more generally, you'd be very hard-pressed to make a case. There is research on this, I'm not just pulling this out of the air. I think you're very hard-pressed to say that we've gotten a dividend in the form of better allocation of capital as a result of the increase in trading volume. Now let's for the moment just say that's right. What does that mean when we decrease the volume of trading? Well, we've eliminated waste in the financial sector. Okay, and that waste is a lot of very high incomes for some of the richest people in the country. If it's still doing its purpose, which is allocating capital to people who need it and facilitating savings for people like us who need to save for retirement, well, then if we can do that with fewer people getting really high salaries, that's great. I've just made the sector more efficient. Okay, so what I would argue is that this is a way to make the sector more efficient and raise an awful lot of money. Okay, which brings me to my last slide. I just have three slides here. The amount of money you raise, there's a debate on this. There's a paper from the Tax Policy Center, which I think was very good on this. I wrote a paper for the Century Foundation last summer, which I believe is in your folders there. Range of estimates, but you know, I would put the range somewhere in the order of 100 billion to 150, 160 billion, depending on the rates. The rate that most often is talked about, a tenth of a percentage point. This follows a tax that might actually go in place in Europe. There's very big interest in this among many of the European countries. A tax of about a tenth of a percentage point on stock trades and a hundredth of a percentage point on trades of derivatives. Now, the analysis, the chart here I'm using are units of stamp, or food stamps. My reason for doing it, there was a question this morning about making these things more understandable. I don't know if this makes it more or less understandable, but in my book, I use SNAP as the main unit of analysis. That's not to denigrate SNAP, but it's, you know, our largest single, you know, anti-poverty program, roughly $70 billion a year. So just saying, how large is this relative to the food stamp budget, to the SNAP budget? So what I'm saying is we can raise somewhere in the order between 1.5 and 2.1 times the annual cost of the SNAP budget, which say is pretty good. The other part of the story, we reduce trading expenses. That's the amount of waste we get to eliminate in the financial sector. So these are the salaries of hedge fund guys. Okay, obviously it's not exclusively hedge fund guys. Some of these are custodians and, you know, administrative assistants. I understand that. But, you know, a lot of this is very high-end earners. And to my view, that's a really, really good thing. It's a big step for equality. So what I would argue here is that we have a tax that it's been around a long time in many different countries, many different formations. It does raise a lot of money, so it's not speculation. I mean, how much we'd raise in this specific context, obviously room for debate. But we've seen many countries where it raises lots of money, and it is clearly administratable. I heard people say, how would you administer it? Well, they do it. You know, they do it in the UK, they do it in other countries. And it does so by eliminating waste in the form of income for very high earners. So to my view, that's a real winner. I don't know if I'm going to trust President Trump in it, but.
First, I'm going to talk a little bit about the views of the incoming administration on Social Security and then turn toward a longer view. So on the campaign trail, Donald Trump repeatedly promised not to touch Social Security benefits. To the extent that he addressed Social Security solvency, what he talked about was reducing what he called the tremendous waste, fraud, and abuse in the program, and also promising record high economic growth. Now, I don't think I need to explain this to you guys, but even if he eliminated every penny of waste, fraud, and abuse, which by the way is not anywhere close to tremendous, it's actually very, very small, and we had record high economic growth, that would do very little to close the structural gap in Social Security's long-term finances. So Social Security does face a significant but manageable long-term financing shortfall. It amounts to about 1% of GDP over 75 years. It has enough money to pay benefits, full benefits, for the next two decades or so, according to its actuaries. And after that, we'll be able to pay 3/4 of benefits just based on current revenues. So it is a problem. We need to fix it. And there are only two ways of doing that. One of the ways is reducing benefits, and the other is increasing revenues. So when Trump was pushed on this at the final debate, he refused to commit to either course of action. Now, Trump is very much out of step with the rest of his party, including soon-to-be Vice President Pence and Speaker Ryan. Both of them were very strong proponents of privatization in the Bush years, and both have continued to advocate for significant cuts to Social Security. So I think it's safe to say there's a significant amount of uncertainty about what is going to happen with Social Security over the next 4 years, and certainly none of us can afford to be complacent about this or about anything else. But we're just going to have to set that aside for now because we don't know what's going to happen. So looking to the longer term, as I said, there are only two ways to meet our current promises to Social Security beneficiaries, either reducing benefits or increasing revenues into the system. Let's talk about benefits first. There's a robust debate about benefit expansions for Social Security. I'm just going to set that aside right now. It doesn't make sense to talk about that in the current context. But talking about just paying for promised benefits. Are benefit cuts a way to make Social Security more affordable in the long run? Well, let's think about that. Policymakers on both sides of the aisle have committed to exempting current retirees and also near retirees from any cuts. So that means, out of the gate, any change that we make is not going to show a dime of savings for at least a decade or more. Historically, policymakers have also phased in cuts gradually, which means that this savings will be slow to materialize. So we just can't rely on benefit cuts primarily over the short to medium term when we're looking to make the program return to solvency. So that's a very important point. And of course, cutting benefits for a program that many Americans rely on for the majority of their income, 60% of American seniors rely on Social Security for the majority of their income, a third rely on Social Security for 90% or more of their income. These cuts could cause serious, serious hardship. So I think we really need to set benefit cuts aside as a part of the solvency puzzle. And I think there's a really good policy argument for looking to revenues. Since the last time policymakers addressed Social Security in 1983, Social Security's tax base has really eroded. Could I just have my first slide? So back in 1983, when you're looking at total compensation, about 3/4 of compensation was subject to Social Security payroll taxes. Now the proportion has declined to less than two-thirds. So there are two major reasons for this big erosion in the Social Security tax base. The first is dramatic increase in inequality. And can I have the second slide on that? As many of you know, Social Security's payroll tax is a flat rate levied only up into a cap. And the cap this year is $118,500. Above that cap, you don't pay anything on Social Security. Now, what happened last time Congress set this cap in 1977, they set it to cover 90% of aggregate wages. Now, wages above that cap have grown much, much faster than average. And so what's happened is right now, the cap only covers 82% of aggregate wages. That's a big difference over just a few decades. Had the cap stayed at 90% of aggregate earnings, it would be more than double where it is now, say Social Security's actuaries. It would be about $270,000 a year. So that's one thing, increasing inequality. The other reason that the share of compensation covered by Social Security payroll taxes has really shrunk since 1983 is that more of our compensation is paid not in wages, but in non-taxable fringe benefits. And the most notably, healthcare, which, you know, of course, costs have risen very rapidly. So employer-sponsored health insurance premiums are not taxed for Social Security, although other health insurance premiums, for example, on exchanges and other not employer-sponsored health insurance premiums are. So that is one area. And then another area is cafeteria plans. And, you know, healthcare is part of that. So are things like flexible spending accounts. Flexible spending accounts basically did not exist in 1983. I mean, they were just minuscule, and they have increased dramatically. And so so that's the policy argument. There's also a political argument. You know, if you look at polls, there Americans, by and large, reject benefit cuts to Social Security. They know they're gonna rely on Social Security. They value Social Security, and they do not want their benefits cut. And you actually find a surprising amount of support, people who are willing to contribute more to Social Security in order to strengthen it over the long term. So I think there's this political argument too for looking to revenues so that we can afford to pay promised benefits. So I recently wrote a paper on this topic, and I looked exclusively at payroll tax solutions. You know, other people are looking outside of payroll taxes for funding sources for Social Security, but I was just looking inside of Social Security's current structure, which is primarily payroll tax based. And I looked at three broad categories of options. And if I could just have my last slide, that would be great. So the first is raising that cap. Now this is definitely the most popular option when you talk to the American people. And so one idea is to raise the cap gradually to cover 90% of aggregate earnings. That would close about one quarter of Social Security's 75-year solvency gap. Another option is to eliminate the cap altogether. Now that raises a whole other set of questions, and that would save a significantly larger amount of money, more in the neighborhood of three quarters of the long-term solvency gap. If you decided to broaden Social Security's base and include fringe benefits, as 401ks, for example, are included, we do pay Social Security payroll tax on our contributions to 401ks. For employee-sponsored health insurance, it would close about a third of the gap. For covering things like flexible spending accounts and cafeteria plans, it would close about one-tenth of the gap. And then finally, you know, we should consider increasing the rate. I think that many people would be surprised at how much a modest rate increase could do to strengthen Social Security. So for example, there's a proposal that would change the rate very, very gradually from its current 6.2% on employees and employers to 6.5%. Once it's fully phased in, it would cost a typical worker about $3 a week. That $3 a week would close 20% of Social Security's long-term solvency gap, and I think that's something that we should be considering too. So I think my message here today is that we all need to, you know, stand strong on Social Security, hold the line for these next 4 years, and over the long term, I think we have some really wonderful progressive options for strengthening it for the long term. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Those were really helpful comments. And I just wanted to ask, before we turn it over to questions from the audience, sort of a theme flowing throughout here and that we've thought about as progressives for a while on inequality is the fact that capital income has increased so much. It's been referred to a number of times. relative to wage and wages and salaries. And I'd like to just, we have a lot of economists here, I'd like to just talk about these specific taxes in that context. Because I'm very concerned when we hear about, you know, the Ryan plan and Trump's proposals and all that, we're looking at a further erosion of taxes on capital and, you know, what that means for us and for inequality and for our goals. So, I don't know, would anyone like to take a stab at commenting on that point in the context of either the particular tax you spoke of or just in general?
Well, I hate to be the nerd on this, but it's something I follow closely. If you look at corporate income, there actually was not much of a shift from labor to capital until the downturn. So there has been in the downturn, and the big question, at least in my mind, is this going to be reversed as the labor market tightens? And it has been partially reversed. The question is, will it be completely reversed? The big shift upward has been within labor. So it's the Wall Street guys, you know, some of these hedge fund guys make over $100 million a year. It's the CEOs, you know, it's John Stumpf, as he's on his way to jail perhaps, he's pocketing somewhere around $100 million for issuing phony accounts at Wells Fargo. I guess he was very productive that way. But that has been the big shift. It has been within labor. So I'm happy to tax capital too. I'm just saying that, you know, when we think of inequality, most of it has been within labor, not a shift from labor to capital.
Good point. Anyone else? What about in terms of regressivity, progressivity? I know a lot of these taxes are thought of as regressive. Certainly, for example, with the Social Security, if you were to increase the rate, currently the cap is, what is it, $118,000? And it seems like it would be better to raise the cap. Most progressives would say that. But I'd be curious, any further comments on regressivity versus progressivity? Are there ways that your tax could be tweaked to make it more appealing? Or are there arguments, this is sort of a separate question, but arguments that you would make to a Trump administration for why the tax you're talking about really makes sense for their goals and their voters?
Well, I guess I can start out. I mean, the VAT, it's a consumption tax, and so it is going to be, it's going to hit consumption and consumers, and so it's a regressive tax. There is just nothing you can do about that. And yeah, I mean, people have come up with the X tax, for example, which is kind of taking value added and splitting it between business cash flow and you know, basically labor share of labor compensation, and taxing one at the firm level and the other with a progressive wage tax on workers. But the thing is, you're still missing capital income in that. And I think one of the things is that you know, capital income is taxed rather lightly. You know, I guess on the books it looks like it's taxed heavily, but you know, when all is said and done, it is taxed rather lightly. And so I would certainly not like to see the income tax go away and be replaced by a regressive tax or a progressive value-added tax.
And I was just in reference to what Tom said, I think that while other countries may spend their value-added taxes in progressive ways, it seems scary to think of relying on that in our political system. I just made that comment. Frank, did you have a comment?
Yeah. So a carbon tax is moderately regressive. It's probably inequitable on other dimensions even more, so like urban, rural, you know, people that have much longer drives or cold versus hot climates, things like that. So it opens up other dimensions. The idea of redistributing some of the money on a per capita basis, tax people in proportion to their carbon emissions, redistributed on a per capita basis, the British Columbia plan, is an attempt to address that. I think that the other side of that is that there is very little that you could do that would do so much for blue-collar jobs as promoting a clean energy agenda. That building wind and solar power and energy efficiency is extraordinarily construction and manufacturing intensive. And in terms of rebuilding the sort of the blue-collar jobs that used to be in the middle of the economy, someone in a union actually once asked me, well, what can you say to steel workers who are worried about losing jobs to renewable energy. And I said, well, take a good look at a wind turbine. They're not made out of cardboard.
So I would like to now assign you and Dean to work for the next 6 months on building the best darn data you can on that point. Are there any questions in the audience? Yes.
Hi, I want to thank you for your panel and workshop. And I think your ideas are outstanding. There's just one thing. Unless you know how the other side ticks, nothing's going to get through. And I've been noticing some things in this symposium help. The reason why Donald Trump did so well is when you're economically hurting, you're not going to do anything about the rich, you can't. But you'll make sure the other guy doesn't have it better than you. Now, I know the things are terrible, but they pretty much say, hey, why should the immigrant get a free ride? Look where I'm at. Hey, why should I share a bathroom with a transgender? Look where I'm at. Hey, why should, oh, so on and so forth. Donald Trump spoke their language. It's unfortunate. It's not right, but that's what he did. Now, your ideas are outstanding. And the thing is that the reason why he trashed the immigrants was because he hated them, because he loved himself. He's all about himself. The same reason a few months earlier when I heard him on a show chastising Pam Geller about her draw the Muhammad cartoon contest, saying this is wrong. He said, this is wrong, you can't trash Muslims. Then months later he did. It was all about himself. The Muslims he was dealing with then had money. It was helping him. The Muslims that he was trashing was, you know, helping his voters that didn't have any money vote for him. And of course we all saw what happened. Again, you have outstanding ideas. But the thing is that you need to get through it. Right now he has an angry society. It's going to get worse with Steve Bannon because he wants the anger on high. So nothing can get through. So we're at each other's throats. So we can't see when he kicks us to the curb. All you have to do is ask Chris Christie. So there's three things I would suggest. One, listen to people, which is what you're doing, what I think you're doing. Two, speak their language. That's what Bernie Sanders did. John Kasich listened to him. And three, work with them on making their lives better. And I think your ideas will help, but it's just getting through. I think you can do so, but you need to know the environment, because if you don't, if you go outside without an umbrella and it's storming and raining and stuff, you're going to get stuck. I don't want to see any of us get stuck. I don't want to see you get stuck. So that's my advice. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your comments. I think that we sort of covered that in a way, talking about the impact on working people, and you were talking about the jobs. And your proposal wouldn't harm working people at all. Yours, depending on how you did it, value-added tax would hurt working people, theoretically, right, Tom? Value-added tax would, yeah. So, yes.
So instead of the value-added tax, there is a way to do, well, there's a number of ways to do consumption taxation that are progressive, and one of them would be a supplemental expenditure tax. That is, you'd have a large exemption and then tax that at a flat or progressive rate. And, you know, it could fit into the agenda of the Trump administration. Because it would do two things. One, it would raise quite a lot of, as much revenue as you want. And secondly, it would compensate or get rid of the imbalance in terms of progressivity that all these tax plans have. So the question is, you know, are Republicans, do they want to lower rates on the wealthy per se? That is, that's their goal. Or do they want to lower rates on higher income earners because those are job creators, you know, and they think that it's more efficient to do that? If it's the latter, then there is room for an argument for a progressive expenditure tax, because that expenditure tax doesn't, in fact, burden capital. And, you know, a small business owner, for example, who doesn't take money out of their business and reinvest it, they don't pay any tax. So that's the, you know, that's, I know it doesn't have a large chance, but it in principle would fit in with the agenda, I think, of that of the administration, and so it's something that could be thought about. And unlike a VAT, it wouldn't need a huge administrative mechanism. It can be done pretty simply through schedules on the income tax return using the information that taxpayers already have.
I guess I'll just say I'm kind of cynical about what their motives are. I mean, it's good to take people at their word, but you know, we've seen so many occasions where they've supported tax cuts where you just sort of scratch your head. How could possibly, you know, increase economic efficiency? I mean, probably the best example would be carried interest deduction. When I first heard about that, I thought the person who was telling me didn't know what they were talking about. And I looked it up and go, wow, that really is true. So then I called a friend of mine who's a conservative economist, he was in the Bush administration. I said, well, you know, why do you have this? I mean, he goes, well, you know, these are really rich and powerful people. And I understand that. I mean, what's the economic rationale? He goes, oh, there isn't one. You know, I think you really have to, you know, take a pound of salt to try and take these people seriously when they're pushing so much. And which is to say, some of them actually believe that, and there's some conservative economists who actually believe that story. But I don't really think that's what we're up to.
Any other questions?
Benefits are tied to earnings. So how would, you know, how would this work out? Wouldn't it cause some problems in the future in the terms of increasing benefits? I know there's a bend in the curve, so it wouldn't take it off. But anyway, it's just something I was wondering.
That's a great question. I would have addressed it if I had more than 7 minutes, but so I'm glad you asked. If you just raise the cap, it's a much more manageable problem as opposed to eliminating it, then you have some serious policy choices to make about what to do with benefits. And the link between contributions and benefits, or earnings and benefits and Social Security, is really important to many people, including important to me. So, we want to think seriously about breaking or weakening that link. Now, when it comes to just raising it to the, you know, to cover 90% of aggregate earnings, I think the choice is more straightforward. So both the Simpson Commission and the Bipartisan Policy Center and their big commissions recommended raising that cap to cover 90% of aggregate earnings. And I can't remember which is which, but one of them maintained the same, just basically extended the 15% replacement rate that the top bracket of earnings gets now up to those newly covered earnings. And the other one created a new so-called bend point, and so that earnings above the current law cap would be replaced at a 5% rate. It doesn't make a big difference in terms of solvency whether you go for the 15% replacement rate or the 5% replacement rate, but it obviously does make a difference for those individuals' benefits. Now, it's a much, much harder choice, a policy and a political choice, when you're talking about eliminating the cap, because you know, you're either going to have people with extraordinarily high benefits, very, very, very wealthy people with extraordinarily high benefits, or you're going to significantly weaken that link between earnings and benefits. And so I think that's a kind of a trickier road to hoe.
Good question. One more. There is one.
I'm like the bad penny that comes back, but the last panel made what I consider a substantial error in equating a 10% corporate tax rate, that it went directly to very high income individuals. And you know much about corporations, the money in the corporation is not the same as the money in the pocket of the shareholders. And the reason for a 10% tax rate is to have the small business, such as the person here that was here before, be able to retain the earnings without their carrying high tax. And so, like comments perhaps that Dean made.
Well, I have to confess, I wasn't here for the last panel, but my view, corporate taxes are at least in large part a way of taxing capital income. If you could be confident that you would get that same taxation of capital income at the individual level, I'm fine with that. One of the things that I thought about, I'm stealing this idea from someone, I've yet to find who I stole it from, but I've had this thought of letting corporations out of the income tax altogether by giving a percent of shares, non-voting shares, and you know, whatever happens if the corporation pays a dividend of $2 to their regular shares, $2 goes to the government on each share it holds. If they buy back 10% of their shares at $100, well, then they buy 10% of the government shares at $100. I think that would be a really good way of eliminating much of the waste associated with dealing with the corporate income tax and making it so it's almost impossible for them to avoid. So I'm, you know, again, the point of taxing, I'm well aware corporations, you know, they're not people. You know, at the end of the day, the money goes to people, and we want to tax the rich people. And, you know, the question is how best to do it. And, you know, if you can give me a mechanism other than the corporate income tax that raises roughly the same amount, I'm fine with that.
There was one gentleman back there that could we take that one more question? I don't know where the microphone is. Or you could just yell.
I could do that. I'm hearing a lot about the economic arguments to be made against a group that really doesn't care about the economic arguments. And I think what the conservatives have been very effective at over the last 35 years, really getting us to focus on arguing about the details as opposed to stepping back and looking at the underlying priorities, which everybody's been pretty blunt about here. But I think we need to take that bluntness out to the public a lot more and not get mired in the, sorry for saying this here, it's kind of heretical, but not, let's not get mired in the economics, but get focused on the social priorities and the class issues that we're talking about here. And I'm wondering if there are any ideas on take your perspective out at that from that point of view.
Well, I agree with you that economic arguments seem to be lost on many Republicans in Congress. I've written a lot of CRS reports going over economic arguments, and they get ignored. And in one case, I guess they tried to shoot the messenger. That was me. Now, the other thing is actually trying to go out, and I'm not the one to go out and come up with a coherent message. I'm a PhD economist, and that's the language I speak. And I, you know, I'm just too old to, you know, learn a new language that other people can understand. I've tried, my mother doesn't understand me at all. But I do agree with you that a message needs to get out there. Now, is it, you know, are you gonna go door to door with an economic argument? You know, I don't think that's gonna work. And at least when I was an Acorn organizer back in the 70s, I didn't come up with economic arguments. One, I wasn't an economist then, and the other thing is, you know, the neighborhoods I was going in, you know, I don't think they'd be open to economic arguments or even understand them. Another big thing is, how do you get the press to understand that stuff? I mean, Dean's been trying to do this for years, and some people, yeah, and others, no. But I agree with you, but I'm not the one to actually come up with a plan on how to do it.
I would add too that I think just as there's a lag on jobs when the economy recovers, I think there's a lag on people being educated when we now have the internet. And I think it will take more time, but I think the internet is a positive development for communicating these ideas, and we have to get better at that. As well as I think someone here was talking about communicating down on the state and local level. I think that's critically important, and not meeting out in states and so forth. But I think your point is very, very well taken, and we all need to heed that. I need to finish because our time is up. I appreciate your sticking around for the hope panel. And you know, that pendulum is going to swing the other way eventually, and we're all going to be ready for it, right? Thank you.
Thank you. We're about wrapped up. I wanted to reiterate thanks to Mark Zuckerman, president of the Century Foundation, who had a lot to do with developing the theme of this. To the names you heard before, Andy, Lucy, and all the staff. To EPI, to all the participants. I do want to make a couple of quick points in summary. We talked quite a bit about a deficit. This was a deficit created by tax cuts. This is a deficit created by tax cuts. The stock market liked it because it liked growth. As Larry Michel emphasized, there has been too much talk among Democrats about the cloud of austerity. President Obama created a balanced budget commission. The Democrats suggested sequestration. Let's not forget that. And Hillary Clinton, advised by many of those Democrats, did not come up with a strong economic plan. Now, eventually, Trump deficits will probably have to be dealt with, maybe not for economic reasons, but for political pressure reasons. And we're hoping that some people down the road will begin to think about tax increases, much as Reagan had to think about tax increases. Of course, his were a little bit regressive. But as the congressman said, be ready for a fight, the fight to cut social programs because of the deficit being created. So we have at least a two-part agenda. Fight to retain those social programs, and maybe fight to increase some of those social programs down the road by developing taxes. We have created a deficit with bad tax cuts. It's an inefficient Keynesian policy because the rich don't spend. Spending on social programs and infrastructure is an efficient Keynesian policy. We'll get more bang for every buck of deficit. But we've talked about good tax increases, bad tax cuts, good tax increases. We talked about tax expenditures. We talked about Social Security taxes that could make the Social Security system solvent in a progressive way. We talked about carbon taxes. We talked about the FTT. Carbon taxes, because with that sand could help us with climate control. We talked about the FTT. We talked about the VAT, which I think some people argue, I don't know if Tom did, that it induces savings by reducing consumption. You probably don't buy that argument, Tom. But Peter Lindert and others said one reason Europe has grown is for that very reason. I'm not so sure I buy it either. I'm much of a says law kind of guy. So thank you all. I think we have an agenda. I think this made the agenda much clearer, and I hope you enjoyed it. I think the panels were exceptionally interesting and exceptionally expert. Thank you.